Good morning and welcome to the 20th meeting of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee in 2024. I've received apologies for this meeting from Paul Sweeney. The first item on our agenda is to decide whether to take item 4 in private. Are members agreed? Thank you. The next item on our agenda is an evidence session as part of phase 2 of our post-legislative scrutiny of the Social Care Self-Directed Support Scotland Act 2013, focusing on monitoring and evaluation. And I welcome to the committee Dr. Richard Bruner, Research Associate at the University of Glasgow, Rob Gowans, Policy and Public Affairs Manager, The Alliance, James Mahon, Economist, York Health Economics Consortium, and Des McCart, Senior Programme Manager, Strategic Commissioning, Health and Care Improvement Scotland. And we'll move straight to questions. And Emma Harper.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, everybody. I've got a couple of questions around monitoring and evaluation of self-directed support. It wasn't really part of the development of the Social Care Self-Directed Support Act, but we seem to be adding more monitoring, evaluation and reporting in a lot of legislation that that has been passed these days. So I'm interested to hear from you that why is monitoring, evaluation of policy, why is that important?
So first, just the purpose of monitoring and evaluation of policy is to make sure it's working as intended and that it's having the desired effect and the intended outcome. I think one of the reasons for the Alliance working on self-directed support over the years is because people have told us that while the legislation is really good and has good intentions, there's an implementation gap in terms of what's happening on the ground, the support people are receiving. They're not necessarily having the choice and control that they should be having, or are necessarily aware of what their options are under self-directed support. This sort of research and engagement we've done, in particular the My Support, My Choice report, which we can we're sort of happy to talk about, shows that when implemented correctly, SDS improves people's experiences of social care. But in too many cases, people don't have full choice and control. Their experience falls short of that. And I think this inquiry is a sort of a welcome contribution to trying to sort of tease out some of the issues around the implementation gap.
Okay.
Thank you. Yeah. Many thanks for the invitation to the committee. And just to follow that through. I'm here in the main to talk about unmet needs in social care, and there's a data gap around that, which is also a great opportunity, really, for the committee and for Scotland in terms of making choices about what we want to monitor and evaluate. The key to successful monitoring and evaluation is about the vision. It's about thinking, okay, what's the vision for the policy that we want to achieve? What do we want to see in 5 years? And then you monitor back from there based on those aims. And we know that the aim of self-directed support is, amongst other policies, to support people to achieve independent living. And it's that I'd like to talk more about today, and about the potential steps for monitoring what we mean by independent living.
Okay. Yes.
Hi, thank you. So being part of Healthcare Improvement Scotland, our purpose is improvement, and key to that is how do we know we're improving? So the monitoring and evaluation is essential, and it's interesting when you're saying that it's not necessarily been there from the beginning. I guess that's maybe one of the reasons we're still in a place of trying to see self-directed support embedded in Scotland, because we've not necessarily had the understanding of what's made it possible, and I think or what's made it difficult. And one of the challenges has been, and you've said that it's increasing the amount of monitoring and evaluation, is getting, as the colleague has said, getting what you monitor and evaluate correct. And at the heart of any improvement, it has to be a learning-based approach. So something which is only about performance doesn't really help us to learn, so what is it we need to change? And in terms of self-directed support, it landed into an environment of care management and a particular system in which the way that health and social care was done and delivered. And what we really needed from SDS was to change that. That's what it was about, and it's seen in the independent review that Feely did more recently, is to actually see change happen. So what we need there is monitoring and evaluation that informs that, and that has to be a learning-based approach rather than just performance. Performance is helpful, but we need that learning focus at the heart of it in order to make the change, to inform the changes that we need to take forward.
OK. Not sure if James Mann...
No, I have nothing to add.
Okay. So, in terms of monitoring and evaluation, should that have been built in right up front? So we started assessing, monitoring, evaluating as soon as SDS was implemented, or is it this part of the process of we're 10 years in? We've got our Feely report. We're looking at what we're assessing. I know Public Health Scotland have good dashboard information about option 1, 2, 3 or 4 and its uptake. And so what are your thoughts about, I suppose, monitoring and evaluating from the get-go? And I suppose I can roll my questions into one. It's what do we need to be evaluating when it comes to implementation of self-directed support?
If I can just pick back up on that same theme, then yes, it should have really been in from the beginning. It should develop over time, so it shouldn't be a case of goal set at the beginning and only seeing have we achieved or not achieved, especially over a 10-year strategy. So it does have to have, as I say, that focus on a learning-based approach, which means that we're saying, what are we observing? Through discussion, what are we learning from that? And therefore, what should we be changing? And that was always the idea of SDS, and if you aligned it to things like realistic medicine, community empowerment, there's a lot of legislation which is putting power in the hands of people. But our system hasn't been built that way previously. That's why we brought that legislation in. So I think what we needed to do to have some core evaluation, and as I say, something simply as how many options 1, 2, 3 and 4 has not really helped us to understand. So what is it that's made any of those possible or difficult? What's the quality of an option 1? Is that through choice or is it because it's the only thing available in an area because of, excuse the language, market availability? What choices are available there? So having clarity from the outset of what are we trying to achieve with this? And for me, SDS was always about the choice and control agenda, as in the paper, it was on my choice. So it's that focus, having not on are we performing against fixed matrix, but actually are we taking a learning-based approach which allows us to, over that 10-year, continuously adapt. But you needed something from the beginning, so it would have been helpful to have something there from the beginning. We are where we are. How do we take that forward now and have some kind of baseline of where we are and what is it we want to achieve from there? Does that help?
Mm-hmm. Okay.
I think that I'd agree with what Des has said. I think there's still data gaps and things that that sort of aren't being collected. So we know about what options people are on, but don't necessarily know if that was their choice or whether there just wasn't anything else available. Were they given full information about it or sort of steered to a particular option? And I think there's a gap in terms of sort of intersectional data and quality data. I think the sort of Scottish Government's health and social care data strategy is a sort of helpful start in that, but there's still, I think, the sort of absence of sort of some of the sort of data on an ongoing basis. And I think one of the reasons that we did the My Support, My Choice research was to find out a bit more about the people's experiences on the ground. And I think that's where sort of some of the things around people not having sort of full information or not necessarily having kind of access to sort of independent support or independent advocacy to sort of help them decide what's best for them as amount. So I think there's still sort of quite a bit more that ought to be done on data to sort of help understand sort of user experiences.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Just to follow through on your question, what do we need to be monitoring and evaluating? You know, I think it's quite timely now to be honest with you. You know, we've had the Feely review in 2021, which has advanced the way that we might think about social care as being an investment in society and a vehicle for independent living. And of course, we've got the National Care Service development running alongside that now. So what do we need to monitor and evaluate? So the self-directed support guidance from 2014, you know, makes it clear that self-directed support is intended to support, promote and protect the human rights and independent living of care and support users in Scotland. And that begs the question of what we mean by independent living, and Feely helped us to think about that. So to quote from Feely, independent living means people of all ages having the same freedom, choice, dignity and control as other citizens at home, at work and in the community. It does not mean living by yourself or fending for yourself. It means having rights to practical assistance and support to participate in society and live it a full life. And that's a definition of independent living that's previously been adopted by the Scottish Government and by the NHS in Scotland. And it's consistent with Article 19 of the UN Convention on the Rights of Disabled People, and of course with Scotland's national performance outcomes. And all our monitoring and evaluation, all our public policy needs to be towards delivering those national performance framework goals. So that's the framework for where we are in terms of thinking about monitoring and evaluation. Now, how do we enable disabled people and older people using social care to achieve that independent living that Feely has helped us to crystallise?
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Gillian Mackay.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning to the panel. I've got a couple of questions for James first, and then probably one for the full panel. So, James, what benchmarking was available to use researchers at the start of your evaluation of implementation of SDS? Was the data sufficient? And if it wasn't, what else do you think you would have liked or needed at that point?
Okay, am I on mute, by the way?
We can hear you.
You can hear me good. Okay, well, I'll answer this by also sort of answering the last question too, but just to sort of quickly... What data was available? Very little. Was it enough? No. So I think the problem is, just hearing the other people speak, there's a danger with evaluation that we collect what's easy to collect rather than what we need to collect. And so if you look what data we have, how many people have taken which option? That's a meaningless outcome. You know, who cares? You know, it's interesting, but how useful actually is it? What you're interested in is what's the outcomes to people? And do those outcomes meet the outcomes that we want them to meet? But then breaking that down, how were those outcomes achieved? And if they weren't achieved, why was that the case? What evidence do we have to show why that wasn't the case? So I think the key gaps we found were largely around outcomes, around service user outcomes, but also around things like how good a quality conversation was being had. I mean, this is key. The social worker element in this is really, really key. How comfortable were social workers talking about the different options? Were they leading people towards one option or another? How creative could they be in solutions? How was that supported by the local authority? Were they using resource allocation panels? Was it consistent across an authority? All these things you need to understand to be able to evaluate properly. And the evidence is completely lacking there in terms of routinely collected data. So, you know, even if you could do a survey that said we're going to look at the outcomes as just was being described and however high level you want, how independent people feel in their living, that in itself is not enough. You've got to understand how that happened and what changed in the system, what still needs to change in the system to improve it. Because almost certainly you're not going to get an answer anyway that if you looked at the outcomes that are going to say, yeah, everybody's happy with how this is all going. So, you know, you've got to understand what's going on deeper. And so was your question what data should be collected?
Yes.
Yeah. I mean, I think we propose several things. There needs to be data collected probably in some sort of social worker survey. I've been evaluating for over 20 years and I'm loath to just do data collections for the purpose of doing a data collection. It has to be focused and useful. My line is, if it's interesting and not useful, then don't do it. Just do it if it's useful. But we came with four or five questions that we thought were absolutely key that you had to understand from the social worker's perspective about how they felt it was working. So that's one area. There was some adaptations to some of the existing surveys that could be undertaken, and maybe wider rollout of the SDS survey, which you'll have to give me. This work was 6 years ago, so I don't know where you are now with doing this. But there needed to be something routinely collected from specifically people who were using SDS with very specific questions about the outcomes that they were achieving through SDS and the challenges that they were having. So there's data gaps everywhere, mm-hmm. but from the service user perspective, the social worker perspective, and to a lesser extent, but still there, from the local authority perspective, because we found that there wasn't just difference across Scotland, there was difference across local authorities and difference between social workers within local authorities and how this is being implemented.
Yeah, absolutely. That variability is something that gets brought to the attention of MSPs on a regular basis. In your conclusions from the study, did you find that actually most of your recommendations were for that implementation side? Were there questions, conclusions around whether the Act needed to be amended, and what do you think would be sort of the top things that we should be looking at as a committee to improve from your study?
I think it would be beyond the remit of what we looked at to say whether the Act needed to be amended, so I'm not going to comment on that, it's not fair. I think looking through what we'd suggested, I think this is a very complex area and very simple surveys may be insufficient to give you the answers that you really want. I mean, we'd suggested doing some proper longitudinal research, looking at people from time of initial assessment through to them receiving report and support and then following them through, because what we found was, when we spoke to individuals, things change. They might have been very happy when they first received the support, but then how flexible was it 12 months in when something changed and they wanted to adapt and change what they were receiving? And there were some challenges that people were seeing there. So if you just stopped the evidence gathering at the point they received the services, that you said, yes, this was wonderful, we had great choice and we've got what we wanted, that would be insufficient, you have to carry on. And I think if I was only going to focus on one area, I'd say, please do that. Please do the longitudinal research so you can follow people through. But again, there's other stuff that can be done. So, expanding the self-directed support user experience survey, mm-hmm. very important to do. But this survey of staff, this survey of what a social worker's doing, and maybe it's because of my background, I used to be the lead economist at the Social Care Inspectorate in England. I did a lot of work with social workers. You know, the people who are the key cogs in the wheel of all this, in facilitating it and making sure it's all working properly and monitoring, you've got to find out what's happening with them and how they're approaching this and dealing with this and the challenges that they're having and the consistency and support that they're able to offer. I'd say definitely do longitudinal research, definitely do a social work survey, and try to do your SDS survey and capture information on outcomes and probably standardised information on outcomes. There's a tool called ASCOT that you can use that would help to get some standardised outcomes, and that would help no end.
That's great, thank you. So I've got one more question, Kavir, for the whole panel, if we've got time. Obviously, there's local authorities collect data, yourselves in different ways will collect data. There's layers and layers of organisations collecting data from service users, and they're not always necessarily sort of joining up across the piece and doing that wider overview. What additional data or evidence do you believe we should be gathering? Or is it the fact that there's different organisations doing different levels of data gathering and we actually need to join it all up to give that bigger picture of individuals' outcomes? Des.
Yeah, thanks. I'm not sure that it's necessarily additional data. I think that's part of what was just said there. It's about how we're understanding it. And I think local authorities, HSCPs, do gather an enormous amount. It goes back to that, is it just about performance and understanding how well on graph, up or down, or is it actually the understanding behind that? And so the example I think we submitted in advance was work done with Social Work Scotland and SDS Scotland. I know you've had colleagues giving evidence from there. And that self-evaluation really spoke to what I think James was talking about there, about staff, because actually understanding what's it taking us to implement SDS, what's making it possible, what's making it hard. And so they used appreciative inquiry. So you do have examples of where people are really getting to that granular, what does this mean? And it's done collaboratively, so that space is shared between practitioners, people using services, wider community, third sector organisations. So what you're then getting is multifaceted reviewing, and it is self-evaluation, but it's very open and transparent. And if you've seen that paper, I think it really kind of it demonstrates that when you have that kind of space, what they've been able to do is been much more honest about what's working, what's not working, because putting that out there is quite difficult, especially what's not working. So having the space to safely say, I'm finding this tough, I can't do this, and having that space therefore to self-evaluate with an openness and transparency with communities, especially at place-based, which is how they've done it, is that you've then got an opportunity to develop a real improvement plan, something that works in situ, in that place, in remote parts of Highland, in the East End of Glasgow, or wherever you're doing it. So I think it's having the right kind of space to look at the data, in a collective way, so that it's understanding that comes from conversation rather than simply observation. We see this and making conclusions. So that kind of real giving, and that really speaks to the power of SDS, is about giving people that kind of central place within that, alongside those who are trying to support them. So it's much more even in that space. Does that help?
Does anybody else want to come in on that?
One of the things that's missing is a bit of kind of oversight and sort of joining up of what's being collected and measuring the right things. I think it's something that particularly the postcode lottery or the sort of unwarranted local variation, I think as Feely described it, is a sort of a huge issue that kind of people have reported is sort of different things happening in different ways in different places, some people being eligible for some things in some areas and not others. I think there's something that we thought that the kind of the National Care Service may have a role in doing that in terms of providing that level of kind of national oversight. It'll be something that it be done, but I think there's a bit of a need for kind of joined upness, of the kind of the data that's collected and making sure that we're sort of measuring the right things as sort of James described.
Thank you. The evidence that Nafsika Zaku and I produced last year on unmet needs in social care. We discovered evidence of a social gradient on what's collected on unmet needs. So the evidence suggests that there's certain groups, such as people with dementia or people facing communication barriers, but also those in greatest poverty and living in greatest isolation are less likely to be represented in large surveys of social care use. We're concerned that there may be a large cohort of disabled adults in Scotland who have perhaps low support needs, but still unmet needs for social care that are not on the radar of social care. A huge potential problem is people who don't see that they have a need for social care. So they have an unmet need, but that's not recognised by them. They're not on the radar of social services. So there is progressive work needing to be done to reach out to groups that are particularly socially marginalised amongst those who should be accessing social care to support them to live independently and well, as the rest of Scotland is. So there is a cohort of people where there is a need for more reaching out in terms of research and surveys.
That's great. Thanks.
Thank you. Sandesh Gohani.
Thank you, Kavina. Just a declaration of interest as a practicing NHS GP. James, can I turn to you with my first question, please, and ask you to summarise the findings of the 2018 implementation study and any recommendations that it made.
Thank you. Unzoomed me. Unmuted me. I think in terms of the findings and the implementation, I think we found variable practice. We found examples where it was working very well. Like I said before, we found variation within authorities as within between authorities. I think in terms of the implementation, it was more of an evaluability assessment, which I struggled to say 6 years ago and struggled to say now too. And it came down to this just paucity of data to be able to say anything concrete. I have to say, sitting here sort of 5 years after the report, if we're still in this same position, that's somewhat disappointing as an evaluator. It's bad enough to say we should have been collecting this from the start and we haven't, to be 5 years after the report and we're still not collecting this information. I don't know how you're going to evaluate it. And I think putting my, again, social care hat on, having worked for the social care inspectorate, I remember going to a conference in 2005, 2006, and somebody was talking about direct payments there, and it was all the to-do, albeit in England, and I remember this lady standing up and saying, I just want good quality services. I'm 80 years old, my husband's always managed the finances, and I don't want to manage my own care, which was her choice, and she felt direct payments was being foisted on her. And I think this idea that there's a danger that you can just look at the data that's there in the option 1, 2, 3, and 4 and say, well, if everybody's doing option 2 or option 3, then there must be lots of choice here. Well, not if they had no choice in any of the options, if we were forced down a certain pathway. And I think the sort of inability to look deep into the data and really what's happening in terms of the choices that people are actually properly able to exercise, the inability to have data to support that. And as an economist, I'm quite unusual because I'm not that fixated on quantitative data. I think quantitative data is all well and good and useful. But if you really want to understand what's happening, then you're going to have to go and speak to people and get some qualitative data. I think the absence of qualitative data at that time, now it may have improved in the past 5 years, but I'm guessing because we're having this meeting, it hasn't improved hugely. The absence of qualitative data to really understand the choices that people are being made. And I think most are able to make, rather. And I think most of the recommendations we made around data capture were about that, to better understand the impact this policy is actually having on people's lives and how well it's being implemented within local authorities.
Thank you for that. I mean, I have to say, one of the things that really frustrates me is when policy or anything is created, surely at the time, we should be having the outcome needs to be, and this is how we review the outcome, and this is the data, and how we're going to gather it, and this is how we're going to measure it when it comes back. And from what you've said, it seems that we don't really know how well things are working. So could I ask you or any other member of the panel, what would you like to see us do in terms of the gathering of data? What is it that we're not having? Qualitative data is certainly something, James, you've already said, but what else should we be trying to gather?
So it's the outcomes, it's the vision of self-directed support that needs attention here. It's what the policy aims to do, as you say. That's where we should be tracking back from in terms of what we need to monitor. So we need a sense of the voices of disabled people and people using social care and disabled people's organisations as part of the Scottish approach to service design and the kind of collaborative co-design principles that we use, I think, very well. But we need that. We need that conversation to be about, okay, what's the vision for well-being for people who are achieving self-directed support? You know, we want people. You know, as Jim Elder Woodward has talked about this in a different context. You know, you need a reason to get out of bed in the morning. Social care isn't sufficient just to help you get out of bed and sit in a chair all day. You know, we need independent living choices for people and measuring what people are able to be and do with their lives with the support of social care. Are people able to go to work to go out, to have fun, to fall in love, to become members of the Scottish Parliament, to move house, to go on holiday, to do all these things that are open to everybody else in society. So we need to be fulfilling our equal opportunities and non-discrimination obligations by thinking about the outcomes that social care and self-directed support is intended to achieve, which is that equality for disabled people and older people.
And I mean, one of the things that James talked about there was how there's some good examples, but the paucity of data means that we don't really know what's going on across the piece. So I wonder if any work has been undertaken with HSCPs or anyone else as a direct result of what the projects that we're doing, as a direct result of the data that we've gathered to make these improvements. You know, if you've got an area which is great, why are we not transferring the lessons that have been learned across? And I'll open up to anyone who would like to answer it.
So, yeah, thank you. So there is work ongoing in terms of, and I guess it's what we spread, is that we don't spread the silver bullet answer. So what works in the Isle of Ede up in Orkney doesn't necessarily work in the same way in the East End of Glasgow. So what you're spreading is not, and it comes to the point I think was made in one of the previous committees about that, and I think you said earlier, Gillian, about the kind of variability of satisfaction and experience. So ultimately what you're looking for is how are we seeing that, and it does come down to the qualitative data that I think James was talking about. How are we seeing the evidence that people are getting that satisfaction, that they feel their lives are better, that they have more control over it? And there is work, so things like Matter of Focus's OutNav work is really beginning to get into a systemic way, or systematic way, sorry, of capturing outcome data, which then allows you to look at and say, so what is it we are learning from that? How is that happening? What makes it possible? What makes it difficult? And therefore, the spread becomes not a silver bullet answer, because that doesn't translate. You have different assets in different communities. And if this is about person-centred practice, then you're building on individual assets, what they have by way of family and friends, or not, what they have by way of community resources. And that's different everywhere. And if we truly want that to be at the heart of it, which I think is what, again, SDS, community empowerment, all these things are about, then it needs to be things which are cognizant of and responding to locality in the right way, so that you're actually seeing this works in the Isle of Ede because, this works in the East End of Glasgow because. But what you're consistently getting is that satisfaction, that experience, the choice and control. Those are the things that you're looking for consistency over, not on the model of care itself. And I think sometimes we've been drawn by models of care rather than actually the values and principles being applied consistently. And again, that's what comes under the Feely report, is about how do we get that collaboration, co-production and all those things? How do we see those manifest in each local community, rather than saying how do we find one answer and spread it? So it's improvement within complexity rather than within complicated. It's being able to understand what it is you're spreading. Does that make sense?
Well, it does make sense, but I would pick you up on a number of issues there. And the first one is, if something works well, we can learn some lessons from it, and we can spread that from an island community to the East End of Glasgow. And I don't see why you wouldn't do that. And that's what, you know, that's a bit of a frustration. And if it doesn't work, that's okay. But this is what's worked up here. What lessons can we learn in a different area? And the other thing to say is certainly, you know, we are 5 years on from the implementation study. So what I'm hearing from the panel is a whole load of things that we'd like to do, but what's happened in these 5 years? You know, what is it that we can point to say, there we go, that's what we're doing, and this is how it's improving? Because 5 years is a long time in people's lives. And I'm just not hearing that it's doing what it's supposed to be doing.
Yeah, thank you. Last year, as part of my research collaboration with Glasgow Disability Alliance, a disabled people's organisation, we were thinking about this, the very problem you're pointing to. Where are the good examples? And I wrote a study based on, it's a small-scale study, 10 in-depth qualitative interviews with people with good experiences of self-directed support. And what was particularly interesting about this was the people in the study came from different local authorities and they were on different options for SDS. And that immediately tells us, you know, there are not some local authorities that do everything well and some that do everything badly. And also, you know, different options of SDS suit different people. So we were able to draw out the kind of principles that people enjoyed when they were having a subjective, good experience of self-directed support. And it was things like being able to be spontaneous, you know, to go out to a gig because you've got flexible personal assistance, or things like being able to plan future activities because you've got a reliable social care system. You've got a social worker who's on your side. It's these kind of principles. So we could see these principles of independent living that I was talking about at the outset coming into play. But we could still see problems for you. We could still see people facing barriers around the issue of care packages being reviewed every year, so people were not able to make long-term plans. People really struggled with being able to go on holiday and do very ordinary things that help us all with our well-being. But that's one example of recent research focused on trying to understand what works in self-directed support. And we've talked to the Scottish Government civil service about the findings from that once or twice, and also presented it publicly too, and there'll be more to come.
Thank you.
James Mahon online wants to come in.
Okay. The inability to disseminate problems that are there and good ways of doing things is it's an issue. And I think it's okay saying, well, okay, there's these particular ways of or particular package of support that somebody wanted in Shetland, and that might not be transferable to Glasgow, and I'll buy that. But what I won't buy is that some authorities are doing things like having resource allocation panels where people meet to discuss the different requests that people have made. I think under option two or option three, you'll have to forgive me, I forget which way around they go. But basically where they won't buy it, but the local authority will sort it out for them. Not everybody does that. Are resource allocation panels a good idea or are they a bad idea? You know, if they're a good idea, they're going to be a good idea probably in Shetland as much as they're going to be in Edinburgh, because it's just a means of making a decision. So if whichever area it was that was using resource allocation panels, if I find they're excellent, how do they disseminate that around the rest of Scotland? And how does somebody say, you know what, this is the way you really should be doing it. Unless you've got a better way of doing it, tell us, and then we'll disseminate that around. And another area I'm thinking of is, I'm thinking of one particular example where somebody wanted to go on holiday. We spoke speaking to a service user, and they wanted to take their carer with them on holiday to care for them whilst they're on holiday. And the resource allocation panel actually met and said, well, you know, risky. It was too risky to do this. It was risky politically. How would this look? What would people think about it? But also just risk in terms of how do we manage the insurance thing. How we manage risk in situations like that will be exactly the same, whether it's in Glasgow or it's in Shetland or anywhere else. And I'm always drawn to this idea. I mean, I'm all for localisation. I think it's great. But, you know, I go into my Tesco, and I live in Berwick. I go into Tesco. They have two types of haggis in my Tesco in Berwick. Maybe they've got six in Glasgow. But, you know, 90% of what they do is exactly the same in Glasgow, in Shetland, in down here. So, yeah, localise where you really have to, but where there's something good that works, disseminate that round and try to ensure that everybody's doing that or something better than that. And I don't know what systems are in place to make that happen.
Emma Harper has a supplementary.
Yep, thanks very much. Sandra Scalhani's question was about 5 years is a long time for change. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm a former nurse, clinical educator. We used to try and implement change on a massive scale across NHS Dumfries and Galloway, and it takes time, right? So, but I was interested, Des McCart, in your, you mentioned appreciative inquiry earlier about how do we use that to help social workers be empowered and be innovative to think about the changes that could be taken forward for what matters to the person in receipt of self-directed support. So be interested to explore a little bit about like change management. Is 5 years too long? And how do we then empower social workers through their skills training. You know, there's like 9 different universities in Scotland teaching social work courses, bachelor's degrees. So are they including appreciative inquiry and self-directed support as part of their curriculum to help social workers be empowered to implement self-directed support in the most effective, efficient way?
Yeah, so I'm not sure consistently, and I think that one of the issues has been, and I think it was spoken at one of the previous presentations about training and around SDS, and I think I saw there that there was inconsistencies identified and what that's like. So I think there is something about, and probably just to say is I absolutely am not saying that it has to be entirely different than across locality, but there is something about saying how does that work? So you're taking a key theme, absolutely consistency around risk, all of these things. There is inherent good practice here. There is just about this adaptability at local level. So it's not a kind of either or in that respect. I think in being able to use models like appreciative inquiry, so the work that we've just recently done with Social Work Scotland and SDS Scotland was about using, and the 3 test sites used different models of self-evaluation, and one was using OutNav. So there is an increasing awareness of how are we using that data in that way? So our people are beginning to do that. And key to that is then being able to bring it together at a national level. So it's not just that each locality does that. Being able to share that across those 3 areas and have peer learning allows practitioners and, again, people using services in third sector to learn from, directly learn from each other about what works. So that transference of knowledge from Highland to East Ayrshire or whatever it be. So we are creating those spaces for people to come together and say, this is how we've implemented in this area, this is why it worked, and being able to share that learning and say, OK, so the tweak we might need in our area is this. So you're beginning to create the spaces for conversation and learning to happen in situ. And I guess one of the things is a recognition that over the past 5 years that working has been more online and virtual, and that has had an impact in terms of new staff coming on and people being able to apply learning. So it's how do we create the spaces for people to come together? Because actually some of that passing on of experience has been much, much harder for staff to do. And at a time where you've had significant turnover, people leaving after COVID, people leaving during it. So you've had a lot, and that's not to point anything, because it's not COVID is it blame there in that respect, but there's a circumstance there that has had knock-on effects. So you've got a different set of environments in which you're trying to apply things. So being able to just simply transfer, I suppose, is my point, is very hard. And using models like appreciative inquiry, using tools like OutNav, are giving people the toolkits to begin to have that shared learning space.
Thanks. Thank you.
Madam Walken.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you. I've been really interested. I was asked to talk a wee bit about unmet needs, and that's been raised in the discussion so far. And it's been really interesting. I suppose my question at this point is around unmet need and eligibility, you know, because there is a conflict there in terms of if we're talking about how do people live their best life. So I wonder if anyone in any of the studies has looked at that sort of interplay between what someone is assessed to need and what the unmet need in the wider context is, perhaps.
Okay, I'm very happy to talk about that. Certainly the unmet needs side, and then move on to the eligibility. I think actually to address that head on, I think there needs to be. In order to assess unmet needs accurately, i.e. to think about the vision of independent living, social workers and others making assessments of unmet needs outcomes need to do that without fear that they are going to be liable in some way for immediately all those unmet needs being expected to be delivered instantly. So we need a measure of unmet needs that's accurate about achieving independent living for people that need social care. And then the eligibility question is a separate question. The resource allocation question is a separate one from that. But what we need in the first instance to understand the degree of unmet needs in social care in Scotland is that freedom to to really go for it, to really understand what the vision is. And in our review of unmet needs last year, we looked at over 100 papers, Nafsa Kazaku and myself at University of Glasgow. And from the evidence, we developed a new definition of unmet needs in adult social care that ties unmet needs to independent living. And I'll read that out if it's okay, because it may be helpful. It's very short. Unmet needs in adult social care in Scotland should be defined as A, the number of adults in Scotland that need any more or amended social care to enable them to achieve and sustain independent living, and B, the range of those unsatisfied care and support needs. So in other words, that's the number of adults that need some more or different social care to be able to live life, as Fiona McQueen, the former chief nursing officer, put it, to be able to live life in all its fullness, and the range of those unsatisfied care and support needs. So we need that outcomes vision to be clear, so that needs to be set. And then the resource allocation or eligibility question is a separate one from that for me.
I don't know if anyone else, in terms of... So the Act itself is acknowledged to be very good. Is there anything within the legislation or the Act that needs to be in place to help that go further? I don't know if anyone has a view on that. Yeah, Rob?
I think we're really happy that the Act is still, that there's not sort of major amendments needed to the Act itself. It's really sort of really good legislation. As I said, it's in terms of how it's implemented. One of the opportunities that we may have with the National Care Service Bill that's will be sort of coming back to this committee shortly, is to look at where sort of some of that national oversight and national consistency can be provided. So around things like data, and as was mentioned before, potentially around sharing of sort of good practice. As was said, the self-directed support can be used in sort of all parts of Scotland. There's some sort of practice sharing that goes on between practitioners, so for instance through the SDS National Collaboration, but that's potentially sort of a couple of things that could be done to provide a bit of national consistency, and particularly around some of the areas of sort of unmet need and eligibility and some of that postcode lottery.
Thank you. Can I just ask one last thing in terms of people having self-directed support if they're seen to have sort of lower or moderate needs? Does that happen just now? Can people dip in for things that perhaps would be seen as additional, like a holiday? You know, how does that happen practically on the ground, or does it? Yeah.
I suppose so. A number of areas have adopted community-led models of social care more generally, and maybe not to the extent that you're talking about in terms of holidays, but about being able to connect into community and actually to find the things. And I guess the hard part of that is that it probably goes nowhere near formal assessment. It probably goes nowhere near options 1, 2, 3, or 4. So again, how do we know that that's happening? So you've got, for example, in the heart of Hoyk, you've got an environment there where you've got public sector and third sector together in that space. People can have a good conversation. And first and foremost, they can be linked into community resources. And what they find is that it gives people what they need there and then, quickly, especially around carer support, for example. So people are able to find solutions. The harder part of that is that how do you then track that? And there's a question, do you want to track it? But there's something going back to that thing, is actually people are able to leave there. That's great, I've been able to go out there. And actually, I know I can go back in tomorrow if I need that. And actually, what that gives you is a real confidence. And we've seen communities being able to say, actually, we don't need as many of these hubs because actually we're much more confident of things. We know where to go. So really empowering people does mean to creating that kind of space where people can come in and get knowledge, so kind of a brokerage support, having independent advice around that. A colleague who's not here today, Anne-Marie Monaghan, would have talked about that, about community brokerage, that thing about being able to connect you into what helps you live well within your own community. And they are not assessed for and provided for and funded services in that way, but they do require public bodies to be able to find the right kind of grant funding into those things, so that you've got the resources around independent advice advocacy, that you've got good, strong community resources that can actually do that. And there are some really good examples across East Ayrshire, Scottish Borders, across the country. There are some really good examples of that. The challenging part of that is that how do we make that more visible in a way which gives comfort in this kind of level to be able to see that that is working.
Listen, thank you very much. Thanks.
Ruth Maguire.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. Thanks for your contributions so far. Most of my questions are for Des McCark. They're around the national collaboration and that learning-based approach to improvement. You've spoken a bit about it this morning, but I wonder if you could define what is a learning-based approach to improvement.
So I have to just be clear, I am here with my Healthcare Improvement Scotland hat on, but we have, as Rob, we are members of that collaboration. And in particular, with a focus, for myself, with a focus on evaluation. So a learning-based approach is, learning is at the heart of any improvement structure. So healthcare's QMS, or quality management system, has a learning focus at the centre of it. And it is that understanding of what is it we're observing. So it's not simply the observation of, it is about what are we learning, where are we understanding, and that comes from dialogue, which is why things like appreciative inquiry are particularly useful tools to make that happen. It comes, our focus over the past few years has been about what does continuous improvement look like in a complex system rather than complicated. So moving away from, so obviously in terms of medical models, it's complicated, but it's more linear, so you can follow. In complex, where you have much more of that kind of butterfly effect, you change something here, and the variability across is much wider. And in that space, we've been engaging with human learning system as a thinking. I think one of the colleagues in previous sessions talked about this. And what really that is about is being able to shift the balance between humans, who normally have to learn how to get into the system, hence the reason you have mostly presenting at GPs, A&E, because they don't know necessarily where to get into the system. So humans have to learn about the system, and the assumption, therefore, is the system is in effect right or fairly right, and people have to find their best way to get support of that. The point of this is about how does the system learn from human beings and begin to evolve and change, and that, therefore, improvement in that respect is not about doing, not just about doing things better, but doing better things. And that's really been the focus. What we're trying to do is how do you shift that focus so you not only do things better, but you do better things as well. And that's a learning-based approach. So what works? Why is that working? What's the mechanism that's making that possible? And that takes conversation rather than simply performance data. And so therefore it's much more into a qualitative space. Does that answer the question?
Kind of, yeah. Right. Yeah, kind of does. I suppose sitting here, like many colleagues, whenever we talk about these systems, it's not an abstract thing. We'll often have specific constituents in our mind who've perhaps been failed, sometimes with tragic consequences. So I guess the most important question for me would be, when will citizens who are in receipt or in need of this support, when will they see changes from this improvement work? When will they see improvement? What's the time frame?
So I think we are seeing improvement now, and goes maybe back to your point about it does take time, and I know that's it's not an easy thing to kind of to accept in that respect. But I think there are a lot of examples beginning to come through in terms of improvement, and I think the Highland example is one of them, where you're beginning to see people experiencing that, both people in terms of those in those local communities, but also staff who are engaging with them. So that whole community element of it, of those who are giving or providing care and those who are in receipt of care. So I think we are seeing that coming through now, I would expect, and the intention for the SDS framework of standards and that self-evaluation is to roll that further out this year. And again, that's across the three organisations supporting that. So over the next 12 months, we expect to see more of that. And what that should bring forward is more evidence of how is this looking in each area and what are they learning and what's there for their improvement plan to make that more real.
Okay. And to what extent can committee be assured that health and social care partnerships and local authorities have access to support for improvement work?
I suppose there are a number of improvement bodies there ourselves, but there are also, I think people talked about in terms of social care, you've got organisations like IRIS and Inspiring Scotland, who have also given evidence here, and then Control Scotland. So there are a number of organisations. I think the important thing is that we are working collaboratively, very strongly in a collaborative way, so that we're recognising that any one of us has clearly got limited resource, but collectively, when we pull together, and that therefore means that at local area, what they receive is aligned support, rather than support which might otherwise pull in different directions, saying this is our model, this is our model, and not doing that and coming in and saying, like, okay, so how do we bring, for example, out not being part of the work in that first round, that's something that a local authority is using as a tool. And rather than saying it's that way or this way, saying, okay, that, how does that tool affect that? And how does that bring it? How does the priest of inquiry do that? So what we're doing as national bodies is also sharing space. So as we did that piece of work, Social Work Scotland, SDS Scotland and ourselves met on a regular basis to share what are we learning about providing that improvement support so that we begin to adjust ourselves and make sure that we are aligned rather than pulling people in different ways.
And is that work accessible to people delivering on the ground?
So our focus has, for the SDS stuff, has also therefore been staff. So it's accessible to staff, and when we support, that's at all levels. So the aim is to support management to then be able to support people. But some of it is direct to staff in that area. Some of that is direct to staff to build the confidence. So in Control Scotland led the Priest of Inquiry work, and that was they hosted. And it's a mixture of facilitation and coaching skills.
I wonder, it might be helpful to say what appreciative inquiry is.
Appreciative inquiry is it's a specific model of reflective practice where you look at, and I'm going to forget the four Ds that are in there at the moment, if you'll forgive me, I can certainly get that information, but it's a well-established model, which is a reflective practice saying, so what is it that's working? How does that work for you? And it's a fairly simple model of it, but it allows the space. So, I mean, we could share that information about what appreciative inquiry is as a model. It's okay. A well-established.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. And James Dornan.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. I'm going to ask about the SDS and the wider context of social care. To what extent do your studies take account of the wider policy and legislative context for SDS, such as the integration of health and social care? And what needs to be prioritised in the wider social care context to ensure the embedding of choice, control and collaboration? Whoever was to ask first.
Yep, Rob.
Yes, I think one of the things that always struck by is that sometimes self-directed support seems to get sort of separated off in people's minds from social care. So it's often, people would describe it as a model for delivering social care, when in reality it's the model for delivering social care in Scotland. So sometimes we feel like we're sort of enthusiasts for a good practice model rather than encouraging people to comply with the legislation that's there. I think there's probably, since in terms of across ways that, for instance, the Independent Review of Adult Social Care and its recommendations, a lot of the areas that we identified in the My Support, My Choice research, sort of fully implementing the Feely review, would address a lot of those. And I think it's considered as sort of about the kind of National Care Service, about how we make people's improvements to the social care that people receive, that their experiences are better, and that sort of self-directed, how it can support self-directed support being being finally sort of implemented as it should be across the country. And I think there's also a sort of a role for sort of leadership from both Scottish government and local government on sort of self-directed support. I think it's always a frustration that it's that kind of more than 10 years on now from the Act passing, we're talking about sort of implementing it, rolling it out into practice and so on. And that takes leadership and also takes resources as well. I think a lot of the issues have been sort of driven by a lack of financial resources, but I think sort of leadership's needed, and I think there is a role for kind of national consistency and sort of and support in there.
Does anybody else want to come in on that point? But I have one or two other questions. Okay. No. What impact, if any, would changes proposed by the National Care Service Bill have on SDS? Does the passage of the bill offer an opportunity to reconsider how relevant legislation ensures the best outcome for people seeking care and support? I don't know if you want to come back in on this, Rob, or somebody else wants to take up.
Yeah, I'm happy to come back on that. I think the Alliance has supported the introduction of a sort of national care service if it's done in the way that responds to the sort of the concerns of people sort of receiving social care, receiving self-directed support, and of the workforce that that work with them. I think there's, as I mentioned, if the recommendations of the independent review of adult social care were sort of implemented as part of this, they would go a long way to addressing that. I think there's some things in the kind of the National Care Service proposals that could be sort of really sort of important for doing that. So to sort of a better sort of complaints process, for instance. And I think there are opportunities from sort of some of the national structures to provide opportunities for kind of ensuring that good practice is sort of shared across the country and providing sort of greater consistency. That said, I think there's potentially a number of areas where the sort of the bill can be improved, and we'd be sort of keen to sort of work with the committee on sort of discussing what those are when the sort of Scottish Government's amendments are published.
You think that the National Care Service Bill might be an opportunity for you to, well, for some of your frustrations to be allayed about the importance of SDS? If during the National Care Service Bill, if the importance of SDS as being the only delivery model is highlighted, do you think that would be a useful part of it?
I think perhaps. I think one of the is that I guess probably the legislation as it stands already would do that. I think it's how it's sort of been seen and implemented in practice. So I guess it's probably the support for kind of practice implementation and also sort of resource for sort of doing that.
Just one last question for the panel. Does anybody think that changes to legislation are required? Sorry?
I think both Des and Richard wanted to come in on that point.
Sorry, my apologies.
That's okay. Des, do you want to come in first and then Richard?
Thanks very much. Just a short point, I suppose, that within the bill there is obviously a focus on ethical commissioning, and I think getting that right is a key part of that it should be fully ethical and putting people at the centre of decision making around how we commission. So I think that alignment of ethical commissioning would be something that would be, if we can get that right, that would really help.
Yeah.
Thank you. Yeah, and in my work funded by the Scottish Government on future visions for social care with Glasgow Disability Alliance, a community navigator is funded, and their role is to support disabled people who are really marginalised from social care And it's really striking how regularly we see the gap between health and social care leading to well-being and significant health problems for individuals, but also problems for professionals, and the services just aren't working together well enough. So last year we produced a report on this, authored by Marianne Scobie, myself and Fiona McAloon, which was called Navigating Social Care, Independent Living and Human Rights. And we're producing another report on the community navigator's work in the next month. So I think everybody's aware that the National Care Service Bill, there needs to be significant more work to bring social care into the conversation so that we maximise the integration between health and social care, and so that people who are lacking self-directed support at home, less people are lacking self-directed support at home and so are less likely to enter hospital. And then if people have self-directed support in place to go back to, then they'll be discharged from hospital much more quickly, all other things being equal. But we all know that, and so there needs to be more prominence for social care in the NCS bill.
Okay, right. Thank you, convener.
Is that you finished, James?
Yeah.
It is. Okay, and we go to Tess White, who has a supplementary.
Thank you, convener. In relation to whether the SDS Act is sufficient and appropriate to achieve independent living, as Feely outlined, I'd just like to ask two questions. The first one is around resourcing. And it was a point that I think Des made earlier in relation to social workers being key cogs in the wheel. So at a previous session, the committee heard about social workers. There's a high staff turnover, that morale is low. And if they're the key cogs of the wheel, then how are we going to improve self-directed support?
Des?
So one of the key learnings from the Highland work was staff feeling empowered. And I think that's one of the things that is being able to, if SDS is about returning power to people, then you need those closest to them in that arrangement also being empowered. So you need frontline staff who are confident and able to make decisions. That is one of the key things that come out of that, is staff feeling that what we're beginning to do is not, our job is to just administer the system as we are told, but actually we are able to bring back information, say that when we're doing that, this is what we're learning is tough, is doable, there's a way that you can improve it, and actually they're being listened to. So one of the key things there was giving that kind of model, was gives staff that opportunity to start to influence and say, we know stuff and we've got useful information to bring into the system to change the system. So that's one of the ways of doing that, is empowering frontline staff so that they do get that joy back into their work.
Okay, so work does need to go there for it to be successful, as you say, key cogs in the wheel. And my second question is around geography. So resources are under pressure, both financial and people resources, but there is a huge disparity between rural and in an urban inner city. And I'm just particularly bearing in mind two of the options in terms of choice, find it very difficult to get carers out to rural areas. There's a disparity in mileage rates, sometimes sourcing own carers, the rates that the councils offers are more centred to the cities. So any comment on that? I mean, it's a difficult challenge, but for SDS to work, it does need to be gripped. I just wonder if the panel have any comments on that. Thank you.
Des?
I'm happy to come back in there. So what we're seeing through getting this ethical commissioning part right, what we're seeing is models where you're realising community assets in a different way. So rather having to employ whole-time staff, if examples come back to places like Bolleskin, Braemar, we're seeing it a lot now in South Ayrshire, where South Ayrshire had a particular problem around that, about recruitment and retention of care staff. What they've been able to do is, through working alongside third sector organisations, is what we'd call micro providers. people, and it's not self-employed PA model, but it is micro-provider, so it's small, very often it is one person. But what the person can do is offer 2 hours or 3 hours at a time, and it's being able to have the system around those individuals which allows that to be useful. So rather than you're either a full-time or part-time member of staff and all that that entails, or actually, so a much more flexible approach to workforce. So we do need, so in those models, they've used things like the open badge system from SSSC, so that people, if they require, or if you're up in that LAVD, if you require something around dementia support, you can use the open badge system to have the proportionate and right training. This is the ethical commissioning part of it, is that we've got mechanisms which allow that to happen, because actually people can give that. And what it's seen in South Ayrshire is people, retired nurses, teachers, etc., being able to offer some of their time, especially in terms of nursing and care staff, so that not wanting to be in full-time employment, but saying, actually, in my local community, yep, I can give that time. What's the mechanisms for that? And that's where ethical commissioning comes in. We need the right kind of mechanisms that makes that happen, and makes that happen safely, so you've still got the same standards in terms of care and quality, but you're doing that in a way which has got... So it's getting some of the dull stuff right, the commissioning part of it, or those mechanistic parts, so that that can happen. And again, and so Rannoch have just started that as well. There's a number of areas across Scotland beginning to move into that, realising community assets and community capacity in a different way, so they are paid, and not therefore saying this is about volunteering, but actually having paid stuff. It might be alongside volunteering. It tends to therefore align to something more than just health and social care, though. So it is things like... handy person sort of stuff. It's that kind of transport. So the alignment of it is about community living rather than just, and that's an important part, because for it to be sustainable, it's not about just creating a health-based or a social care-based service delivery model, but actually something which is about sustainable community living, which means that, again, people maybe have two or three jobs. But those 2 or 3 hours, and if you've got 10 people in local rural communities, 10 times that begins to make a significant difference. So, again, we're seeing those models coming through more and more at the moment.
Thank you. That you finished your questions, Tess? Thank you.
Yes, thank you.
Thanks. Can I thank the panel for their attendance today and for the information that you shared with committee. The next item on our agenda is consideration of one negative instrument, the Food Additives and Novel Foods Authorisations and Miscellaneous Amendments and Food Flavourings Removal of Authorisations Scotland Regulations 2024. The purpose of the instrument is to implement the decision made by the Minister for Public Health and Women's Health in relation to 8 regulated food product applications. It authorises the placing on the market in Scotland of 4 new novel foods, authorises a new production method for 2 food additives and a new use for 1 other food additive, and authorises the removal of 22 food flavouring substances. The instrument also provides a maximum limit for residues of ethylene oxide in all food additives, and corrections of minor technical errors and omissions are made into existing novel foods and to existing food additive authorisations. The Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee considered the instrument at its meeting on the 11th of June 2024 and made no recommendations in relation to this instrument. No motion to annul has been received in relation to the instrument, and I believe Emma Harper has a comment.
I do. Thanks, Convener. So just hearing what you're saying about the removal of 22 products and then the changes to other foods coming into the market, I just want to raise again that my concerns about the colours, the flavours, the emulsifiers, the stabilisers, the chemicals that are added into our food supply chain. Just looking at stevia, for instance, it interrupts gut biome and can affect people's hormone levels, and I read that it can cause depression. There's other issues around ethylene oxide. It's carcinogenic, mutagenic. Ethylene oxide residue I mean, it's used to sterilise surgical instruments and medical devices. That's where I've learned about ethylene oxide from. And now it's used as a pesticide and a sterilising agent for food. So there has to obviously be some standards required for minimal amount of ethylene oxide residue when it comes to food supply. But just in reading our documents, the Food Standards Scotland and Food Standards Agency have reviewed the European Food Safety Authority, EFSA's opinions, along with all the documentation of what we're discussing today. And I'm just interested in this issue around everything that's coming onto market with novel foods and stuff. There's also the one issue where the novel food acetylated fatty acids has a maximum level of 1.6 grams per day in the EU, whereas GB's maximum level is 2.1 grams per day. And acetylated fatty acids are not naturally occurring, except for in some dairy products, and now it's added to our food. So I'd be interested to hear why it's 2.1 grams per day in the UK or in Great Britain, but 1.6 grams per day in the EU. I'm assuming it's to do with safety and it's a safety margin. So I just wanted to raise concerns around this continued issues of chemicals that are coming into our food supply.
So would you be content then, Emma Harper, for committee to write to the Minister and ask about the concerns that you've raised?
I think if that would be agreeable with the members of the committee, it's just to seek some affirmative as per the safety aspects and the discrepancy of 1.6 versus 2.1 EU versus Great Britain grams per day requirement.
OK. It looks like, from looking around the committee, that members are content for us to do that. I'm certainly happy to do that. I propose, though, that the committee does not make any recommendations in relation to this instrument. Does any member disagree with this? No. OK. Next week, the committee will hear from the Minister for Social Care, Mental Wellbeing and Sport as the concluding oral evidence session as part of Phase 2 of its post-legislative scrutiny of the Social Care Self-Directed Support Scotland Act 2013. And that concludes the public part of our meeting today.